Hey Podders, welcome to episode 81 of CosPod, the podcast for all things cosplay. As you can see, Val is currently working on cosplay, reinforcing the fact that we are about all things cosplay.
As for sure. Definitely for sure. However, my ineptitude at putting yarn into a needle is definitely speaking volumes today. That is for certain.
Well, it's a new year, it's a new start with new cons, and it's already crunch season.
Oh, my goodness, is it already crunch season. We'll be talking about that today, too.
This isn't even counting for those who have already been to IckyCon.
Right.
For them, crunch season was already last month. So this is for, 2015 cons that are not IckyCon. We've already started con season. We've already started con crunch. There are people who are already prepping for Matsuri. There are people prepping for MAGFest. I mean, there are people prepping for Dallas Comic Con. So there's all sorts of things already going on in the calendar. And we just started.
And so don't forget KatsuCon. That's the big old one, too.
Yep. It's like we just... I think we end up getting maybe a little bit less than a month of a break before you're already prepping for the next year.
Exactly. It never stops. You just keep going.
January through November.
Mm-hmm.
Like mid-November. And then basically you hit Thanksgiving and Christmas and there's less of it. There are still cons. There are less cons. So you get this little itty-bitty bit of a lull, and then right at January, December 31st, January 1st, IckyCon usually falls right around New Year.
IckyCon is New Year.
Bam, you start con season again.
Mm-hmm.
It's year-round, man.
All right, Val has given up on the yarn. She is moving back to thread. It's not going to look as cool, but you know what? At least I can get the thread through the needle.
Which, speaking of New Year, if you guys see me, constantly glancing over to the side, it's not because I'm not paying attention, and it's not because there's something shiny over to my left. There isn't.
She's not paying attention.
No. Because I'm on call for work, and we just underwent a rather large system change, so I'm just kind of monitoring things to make sure nothing breaks.
She just doesn't like us enough. It's okay. It's okay.
Totally don't like you enough to have been doing this for 4 years now.
Exactly. She hates me now.
Hey, when I first started thinking about this, I didn't even think I'd get off the ground, man.
Right?
I didn't know much of anything about podcasting by that point.
And look where we are now.
And I was like, we're veteran podcasters now, man. Woo!
Actually, it's interesting, and this will be sort of intro and sort of not intro. We'll kind of flip it together. So tomorrow I'm going to be on a podcast called Trade Paper Hacks. They're based in the Dallas-Fort Worth area. And I've won a contest of theirs. It was initially just to get a free comic book. And I was like, oh, cool. And after talking to one of the hosts, who is somebody who I happen to know, didn't even realize he was hosting the show, he was like, yeah, we want you on our show. I was like, oh, cool. Started talking to him about my podcast and the things that we do and all that stuff. And he listened to a couple of our episodes. And he was like, man, you guys actually sound really professional. How long have you been doing this? 3 years? He's like, oh, yeah, well, we have a little dog and pony show, so don't worry about it. We've been doing this forever and a day. I don't know how to answer that. So yeah,
hey, long as cosplay is a thing, we'll probably still be doing it.
Yeah, exactly. So and they've had their podcast for a little while now, maybe about a year or so. But this is like their second iteration of the podcast. So I was like, oh, okay. It's kind of nice to know that other podcasters recognize how quirky and interesting we can be. Obviously we have some idea of what we're doing, maybe not all the time, but sometimes.
Well, we're really good at pulling it out of
our butt
places.
Yeah. No, it's coming out of the butt. We can say that. It's fine.
Okay. I don't even know where mine comes out of half the time. Some sort of ethereal region that's somewhere up here.
There you go.
Alright, so since you're working on cosplay, do you have any updates on things you've been working on for the upcoming PAX?
For the upcoming PAX? No, actually. All of my things for PAX have been completed. I'm working on commissions for other people at this point, because it's nice to have pocket change. Very nice to have pocket change, especially at PAX. Even though PAX is more of an expo, and I'll be talking a little bit later about what I plan to do there. So it's not really a place where you shop for merch, but when you do shop there, you do end up spending quite a bit of money, so it's good to have a little bit of extra pocket change on hand. So yeah, my space is a little cluttered right now. I'm working on some sculpty pieces to make jewelry. You can kind of sort of see it. The shadow's funky. I don't care. There we go. I've also decided over the past 2 weeks that I hate Warbla. Warbla sucks. I don't want to use it ever again. I'm going to find somebody to take my scraps away because I just don't even want to see it anymore. Yeah, I might give them to you, Amber. There's there's a piece maybe about, you know, yay wide-ish. But I also have a bag. Yeah, I have a bag of scraps too. And I mean, Warbly, you can essentially just roll it all together and then just reuse it again. So
I can use it to mold the upraised designs on your foo sword.
Yeah, that could work too.
Because that way you don't have to worry about it flexing.
Yeah, yeah. I just don't like Warbla. I don't... It's easy to work with, I'll give it that. It's very easy to work with, but once you start putting paint on it and you start priming it, even when you use gesso and other things that are supposed to be bendable and flexible, it starts losing the dexterity to it.
Gesso is not as flexible as people think it is.
Yeah, it's not. I know it's not.
Well, I mean, just saying this in general for people, that when you use thermoplastics, and this is for those who have never used things like Warbla, Wonderflex, Styrene, Sintra, things like that, those are not meant to be flexible pieces. Yes, they have a little bit of flex to them. All plastics do. But if you're choosing to use those materials, it's because you want a hard exterior. You want a shell. And that's purposeful, and that's fine. Just for those who have never used it before, just bear in mind that that is purposeful. You're not going to be able to, you know, bend over at the waist like you could with, say, craft foam. Which I know you're a big fan of craft foam.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Craft foam is awesome on so many levels. I love craft foam. Craft foam is, like, the bestest thing in the universe. But here's the thing, is that when people talk about Warbla, they talk about these properties of it where you can make it hard, but you can also make it bendable and flexible. And it's just like, yeah, in its raw state, it's very flexible. It's kind of cool.
Right.
When you start adding stuff on top of it,
yeah.
No. When you fix it.
Yeah, because Warbla is actually a resin impregnated fabric, heat causes the resin to start to cure. Yes, you can heat it up, you know, supposedly infinite number of times, but I suspect that the more you heat it, the more it loses its structural integrity because you're constantly forcing that chemical reaction of the resin that's in the Warbla. So I don't think you can do it infinitely. I think, you know, just like if you were thermal heating plastic milk jugs, which, yes, kids, you can remelt plastic jugs like milk and soda 2-liter bottles and have your own thermoplastic. Yes, you can. However, the max number of times you can reheat that kind of plastic is usually about 3. And it's already been formed once to form said milk jug and or 2-liter bottle. So you only get 2 more. And then it loses its integrity. And then you can't use it anymore and you get a blob. Don't ask how I know this.
Amber likes playing with fire.
It doesn't need a fire, just a heat gun and or a double boiler.
Amber likes playing with fire.
I do enjoy playing with fire, yes. I can't disagree with that.
And that's going in the yearly special.
Only because I spin FirePoint. I don't want my new coworkers to think that I'm a dangerous person because I say that I like playing with fire. I spin FirePoint, and I safely use fire for other things. With purpose. I don't just randomly light things on fire. Normally.
I was letting the soundbite end because I'm using that for the yearly special.
I feel like I've been caught red-handed.
Pretty much, yeah. anyway.
Yes. Should you wish to bequeath unto me your Warbla scraps, I will make use of them for your props.
You are more than welcome to them. I'm going to stick to Wonderflex for the time being on my hard stuff because that I have no problem with. Whenever I'm making the hard stuff, it's usually not curves. They're pretty flat, and I've had no trouble with this. Plus, it has a lower heating temperature, melting temperature. So I'm able to get through it really, really quickly versus the Warbla. And I still have a full sheet of that sucker left, so yeah. The Warble is all yours. I don't want to use it again. I'm going back to craft foam. As soon as PAX is done, I'm remaking Rosa's armor completely out of craft foam and telling the universe to go fudge itself. and the last thing
Alrighty
I did is...
Alrighty then.
I know. The last thing I did, you see the staff in the corner? I made a staff. Look at that. I grew up.
You can't see it.
It's right there. I'm pointing.
It's off screen.
How is it off screen? On my screen, it's totally on there.
Oh, okay.
Well, you know what? Fudge it. It's probably going to be on my screen when we cut to it, but there you go. I made a staff.
Okay.
There you go. There's my cosplay experience. Your turn.
Well, I have not had very much time in the last 2 weeks to be doing much, simply because the long and short of it is I have a new job. Finally, you know, doing what I've been trying to do. And I don't want to say too much more than that because I don't want to jinx it for one, but I also don't want to poison the well for two. So I will just say that I have a new job. It is going
Yay.
To affect my schedule. It is going to affect my schedule a little bit. So if you see me being a little bit more scarce on the podcast for just a little bit until I get accustomed to my schedule, that's why. So there's that. So what I have been doing in the few hours that I have when I get home each night from work, when I haven't been working on new job stuff, is patterning. And of course, when I pattern out, I use poster board because poster board is cheap and plentiful and available. So I've been, you know, this is the side piece for Cosmos Armor. So I did the side piece and I finally finished the chest harness, which you can see is quite large.
Although oh, wow. That looks nice.
This is shorter than it should be. Because I have low bust, so I can't make it any longer than this, or else, you know, the medallion at the bottom would be to my knees. So I had to shorten it just a little bit. But yeah, there's my poster board front harness piece. And then this is half the crown, and I have to kind of, you know, trace it onto another piece of poster board and tape it together so I get a whole piece. So I did that. So all I have left now is just the bracelets. Which I'm still having a lot of trouble doing some of this patterning. I'm having to guess because the reference pics are so low res that you can't see detail. You see fuzzy pixels, which are great from far away, and the picture is about this big on a screen. But ideally, I'd like something, you know, where I can zoom in full screen and I still see the details.
There to note, this is like a PSP game, and the screen on the PSP is like maybe that big. So
yes.
I understand. I get it.
So really even the models has, are...
Yeah, the models are not going to be as great. You're only going to have like her original character design, and that's about it.
Yep. So I saved the highest res, largest reference pics that I could, and I'm just kind of doing educated guesswork from there. You know, all you can do is the best that you can do. And I already have the plastic gems that I need to be able to put them down, because Plastic Beads Wholesale is a wonderful place. No, they don't sponsor us, but they do have pretty awesome plastic gems if you ever need them, and many sizes and shapes, oddly enough, and they're good quality. So I have leftovers from when I did UA that I will use on this. And I still have to do the earrings, and I have to finish patterning out the halter, the weird zigzaggy pieces that go around her neck. But other than that, it's just a matter of making it. Yes, I am going to stick with the broadcloth. I don't like doing it. I don't have enough of the other nicer fabrics. Like, single fabrics. If I mixed them all together, I'd have enough. But it would look really slapdash. So, if I want it to look uniform, yes, it's going to have to be broadcloth. I'm not doing fishtail style. It does not complement my body shape. So I'm just going to do a standard pleated skirt. And then Grecian-style sandals. And that's going to be it. So now I just have to start tracing this stuff onto craft foam, because I too enjoy craft foam. And styrene. So that it has a nice hard finish on the outside. Because styrene is actually somewhat flexible. It's more flexible than the others because it's thinner. This is why stormtroopers use it, because they can actually move around. So I will be slowly doing that over the next month or so before I actually start sewing the dress. It shouldn't take me very long to finish it. It would be a lot easier if I just had a weekend where I could just sit down and sew and do nothing but craft. Unfortunately, with the house the way it is and having the new job and being on call, I haven't had free time the way I need it. And I keep having to get my car fixed. Arrgh. Aging cars are not cool, although, to be fair, it was pretty routine maintenance this time around, just parts wore out. I still have one thing I have to fix in it, and then it will be fine until the next thing breaks.
It's a circle of life.
Yes, I was going to go to Golden Door this weekend, but I opted not to. It's so far away for me now at this point that it's not worth it just to get 4 yards of knit. Because that's all I need at the moment.
Right.
And for those who do not know what Golden Door is, because there are so many people who speak of it as a mecca.
It kind of is, yeah.
It is a sort of fabric mecca. It is a giant fabric distribution center that is in North Dallas. And it is very large. It is a warehouse. And they stock quite a bit of fabric. So if you need fabric in bulk and you wish to actually go physically touch it, you know, feel it, preferably do not lick it, do not get things on it. But should you wish to experience it in person, Golden Door is generally one of the first places people will tell you to go. And they do have really decent sales the few times a year that they do have sales. So that is what Golden Door is. In fact, if you look back at previous episodes, we did a journey there once for one of our episodes.
It was an enjoyable experience.
Yes, we showed everybody how to test the drape of fabric, you know, how to test the texture, and basically what to look for when you're buying fabric in person. So if you missed that episode, go back and watch it. It is rather funny. I haven't changed much.
So good times were had there. Many good times.
Yes, I was still the fall guy in that episode.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
Well, since you are so giving of words, perhaps you should give us the word that is PAX South.
Segway. We haven't done one of these in a while. Segway. All right. Yeah, so next weekend is going to...
I'm in post, I'm waiting to see a little animation like you see sometimes on, like, The Daily Show of a little Segway just going across the bottom of the screen.
I'll work on that.
I'll look forward to seeing that one day in post.
I'll have to have somebody make the animation because I will admit that I don't animate things. I am terrible at that type of stuff.
If any of our listeners are animators and want to contribute to the show, all we need is just a little segue going across the screen. That's it. Anyways, PAX South.
Oh, goodness. So anyway, yeah. This upcoming weekend is going to be PAX South. It'll be the inaugural PAX for the Southern region, which is awesome. Yay! I've been excited for this since they announced this back at PAX East earlier in 2014, and as soon as tickets were up, I had my finger on the buy button, and I was ready to go. So it's going to be a fun weekend. Now, it's not like typical conventions, it's an expo. It's there to showcase video games, new products. Also, a lot of indie developers are there, so it's really about games and the gaming crowd. It's not really about cosplay. There are a couple of panels, but it's not really about that. It's about us going there to be giant nerds for 72 hours, and then some. It's essentially what it is. But I think that this particular PAX compared to other ones is going to have a really huge cosplay turnout because of where it's located. And people don't realize this, and I've seen this commented a couple of times on a couple of popular websites, you know, oh, there's not a whole lot of cosplay in the South. And I have to tilt my head and go, are you living under a rock? Where are you not looking? Where are you not going? Because there's cosplay all over the freaking place, particularly in Texas. There is a huge following in San Antonio, really big following in Houston, like ridiculously oversized following.
There's a reason why we host so many conventions in our state. There are plenty enough people who will attend them, usually in cosplay.
Yeah, it's a big state with a lot of people, and because of our central location, yeah, we're in the South, but when you think about all the states that surround us, we're actually pretty easy to get to. We get a lot of people from Oklahoma, from Kansas, from Alabama, Louisiana, you name it. They all come down here, and it's just a nice spot for things to happen. So it's going to have a huge costume turnout, and I think that's going to completely blow the PAX organizers' minds. They have no idea what's coming. They have no clue. I've even organized an event on Friday specifically for the quote-unquote Southern cosplayers, but anybody can show up for it. And it's just an hour of us hanging out, just having fun, being cosplayers all together. And I've already have at least 70 people RSVP'd to show up for this. So yeah, it's going to be a big turnout. And as you guys have seen from my PAX East pictures, I don't have a whole lot of photos that I post up. Usually it's about maybe half cosplay, half just random things I see on the floor. I think this time it's going to be very cosplay dominant. There is one cosplay event that I am aware of on Saturday. There's going to be one through Gearbox, who is local to DFW, and this is basically going to be their home convention. They're having their Developers Day on that Sunday. So basically, PAX has given them their own special room, their own theater, their own venue. They're going to have their own schedule separate from PAX. So it's going to be kind of cool. But on Saturday, for about 2.5 hours, they're having their own, like, what do you call them? Cosplay is not cosplay chef. What the heck am I thinking?
Iron cosplay.
Thank you, Iron cosplay. Well, I don't know why cosplay chef came up, but
because Iron America,
yeah. Iron Chef. You know, it's all in there. But essentially like that, where they're gonna have two groups of cosplayers coming together and creating outfits. I'm assuming from one of their franchises, but it's gonna be random stuff in the boxes. And knowing how zany Gearbox is, I'm curious to see what the magical items in the boxes are going to be. Because it's going to be very unconventional. I think I'm going to have to drag a couple of people to come and sit on that. That's going to be a lot of fun. What I'm most looking forward to is just seeing all the new things that are coming out in 2015, getting a chance to play all the indie games, and just being a dork for the entire weekend. They announced that they're having 2,000 square feet of retro gaming. If I don't see anything on the expo floor, I'm probably going to be in the retro gaming room the entire weekend.
I'm also speaking of retro gaming, just mm-hmm. side tangent. I'm sure
yeah, go for
a
it.
Lot of you have heard about this. Go to archive.org because they have started hosting retro games, PC games, arcade games, emulators for free.
Lots of good stuff.
So if you're a gamer, go visit. You will spend many happy hours just playing through dorky games.
And that's essentially what I'm paying to do for an entire weekend. There you go. Among other things. Yeah, it'll be a fun event, and I'm looking forward to it. I'm looking forward to seeing how PAX is going to grow over the years, especially here in the South. Like I said, they have no idea what's coming to them. They just have no clue.
Well, it'll be a blast. They'll learn very quickly.
Oh, yeah. They will learn very, very fast. I think they're taking up pretty much all of the convention space, which it sounds about right. I think they're estimating about 40,000 attendees for the first year, which is about on par to what they had for first years at, not PAX Prime, but at PAX Australia and PAX East. I think PAX East was maybe about 25,000. So yeah, they're setting a high bar for themselves, but they should. I mean, they've been doing this for quite a while now. Mm-hmm. My only regret is they have this thing called Omegathon. They do it maybe about once a year, and they just pick a random PAX to do it at. And if you win it, you get to go to another PAX of your choice. They'll pay for everything for you, which is cool. I opted not to do it because I wanted to experience the expo. But they released the game list maybe about a couple of weeks back, and I'm kicking myself in the butt because I could probably win the thing. They're doing things from like Mario Kart Double Dash, which I admit to a lot of things. My mission list is really tiny. I know that I'm a strong, ethical worker. I'm very organized. I kick butt at Mario Kart. You name it, I kick butt at it. And I totally would have wiped the floor if I had chosen to enter, and I feel like a dumb butt for not doing that. But they're also having Katamari, which is one of my favorite PlayStation games ever. I mean, come on, how can you not love Katamari? But they're also doing board games like Operation. So, yeah, it was like, man, I just looked at the list, and I'm kicking myself going, man, I should have signed up. I probably could have made it to the finals. So, other than my one regret already, I'm really looking forward to this upcoming weekend. It's going to be a blast. I'll try to take as many cosplay photos as I can. No promises, but I'll try.
Fair enough.
What to look forward to, kids? Yay.
Yep, and we will have a full report, you know, after PAX South is over and Val has recovered.
Mentally and physically.
It's a heck of a drive down to San Antonio.
I'm not too concerned. I don't mind driving. I like driving.
It's a long drive.
It's a long drive, and that doesn't bother me. It's mostly traffic. Traffic is what gets me. I hate traffic. And DFW's poor traffic.
For those who have never driven around Texas before, it isn't just that we have Texas drivers, which are nearly as bad as California and New York drivers.
They're their own breed of special.
They are, and we have it combined with perpetual construction on our highways.
Good gravy. There's construction everywhere. You don't understand.
Not just in DFW. It's all of the major thoroughfares around the state are perpetually under construction somewhere because somehow these companies keep running out of money to do the project, so the projects just sit in a state of half-doneness. And it's really frustrating as a driver when you have this four-lane highway down to maybe two, sometimes if it's really bad, one lane.
One.
Yeah, if you drive down to Texas Renaissance Festival, I-45 goes down to one lane in some places.
It's so ridiculous.
It's like, come on, man. Really? Can't we just have a high-speed rail that just takes us from north to south Texas in half an hour?
That would be nice. They're working on that. That'll be done, like, what, 2025? Were they they estimating?
You know, Elon Musk's team said they were going to build a test track for the new Hyperloop that he's trying to build here in Texas. They'll have a little 5-mile test track where they'll have pod racing, which made me think of Star Wars.
Heck yeah! That's like the best part of episode one.
Yeah, so we will have pod races down here in Texas, kids.
I would totally be okay with this. Oh my goodness, I would totally sign up for this. Ah! Like a 4-year-old, oh my goodness.
They're saying they won't have an operational prototype for many years yet, so.
Yeah, unfortunately.
All we'll get is the test track for now. We'll get the prototype, but we won't get the full real thing for many, many years yet, so we'll have to deal with the traffic.
Yeah, the unfortunate thing, the thing is with Texas, it's not like they just work on one road at a time. They work on all the roads all at the same time. So it's
all
like,
of the road. It's not just like, we're working on all roads and just this little bitty bitty piece. No, they tear up half the street. Well, half if you're lucky.
In my case, based on where I work currently, every single road I drive on is under construction. Every single road. I wish I was kidding, but I am totally not. Every road I drive on is under some form of construction. And it sucks so much. I'm fortunate I haven't had to have my tires replaced, but man, I have had to have my suspension replaced. I've had to have my car aligned more times than I can count in the last 3 years alone. And that's really not normal for a vehicle. And it's just because of the construction. I can't do anything about it. It's not right. Darn you, Texas. Okay, so on that one.
Well, it should be worth it to go to PAX South. PAX South sounds like it's going to be a heck of an inaugural year.
Oh, yeah. They're going all out on this. We are looking forward to it. And also all the fun after parties. That they have tons of awesome after parties.
Oh, yes.
All the things.
So on that note, I believe you have a tutorial for us.
I do. I'm keeping everybody busy, so I made a quickie, easy glove tutorial for everybody that I hope that you all enjoy. Hey, everybody. Today we are going to be doing a tutorial over how to make gloves for cosplay in a very, very easy manner. As many of you know, gloves are pretty common for a number of costumes, but they can be very cumbersome and they can be a giant pain in the butt to make, especially when you include darts and gussets and you have all these strange lines and it's not fun to handle. So, as for example here, I hated making these things. There are so many lines. Dislike them immensely. So, I came up with this really random idea that seems to work really well if you need to make gloves that are specialized to your costume. Maybe it's in a fabric that not quite available for your costume or whatever the case may be. This is something that's really easy to use, easy to make. You could probably get a pair of gloves done in about an hour. The materials that you're going to need, it's easiest to start off with a glove
that is made out of a knit or a woven fabric. You can buy like a pack of five of these from Target or Walmart for like $4.99. They're uber cheap and they're pretty comfy to use throughout the rest of the year. So get yourself a pack of throwaway gloves. It needs to be made out of a woven fabric, something that is stretchy, otherwise it does not work. You will also need your material, which is going to be a four-way stretch fabric. It's the only way this works. So it could be Lycra, spandex, whatever. It can even be out of jersey, but it has to be four-way stretch. And then, of course, you have your scissors and your pins. One of the reasons that I like to use these pre-made gloves that you can get on the cheap is that the seams are already quote-unquote woven into it. So you don't have to do a lot of guessing. And you're picking something that already fits your hand anyway, so you don't have to worry about resizing. You don't have to worry about going out and getting a new pattern. The pattern's right there in front of you. So first thing that we need to do is take everything off the table, and we're going to cut your glove in half. Time to destroy it. Be as gingerly and as careful as you can be. This is probably the most time consuming portion of it, just because you gotta cut along those seam lines. And when you're cutting, you wanna cut all the way around except for the area where your thumb is. So from that line from the top of your thumb to where the end of the glove meets at your wrist, you want to keep that together because this is basically going to be a pattern for one glove. Dangly hands. There you go. So see, there you go. It's attached at the thumb still. But if you start spreading it out, you can kind of get a better idea of what it's going to look like when we stick it on our fabric. So there's your pattern. Moving from there, lay out your fabric and start pinning it to your fabric. Fairly simple process, and I'm going to start speeding this up because you really don't want to watch me for 20 minutes pinning. This is also the reason why I like using the woven fabrics on particularly the gloves, because it stretches with your spandex or with your Lycra or with your jersey. So it moves with you. And this particular pattern I am making for Rosso the Crimson. So her gloves are going to be elongated both at the wrist. It's actually going to go up to pretty close to my elbow, maybe about mid-forearm. And then she also has nails that are built into her gloves, so I'm going to be extending out the fingertips as well. That's also one of the reasons why I like this pattern, is that it's really easy to modify once you get the base down. You don't want to transfer this on over to paper, because paper doesn't bend and stretch with the fabric. That's why it's best to kind of use the original glove. And then when you cut it out, I like to cut it out in one big hunk before I tailor it down into a smaller piece, just because I sometimes make mistakes while cutting. Then we remove all of those lovely pins. And then we are going to fold the glove wrong side out, so the side that you want to be seen on the outside is going to be folded inwards. You're going to fold it at the thumb line, and then you're going to start pinning like crazy. Pin all over the place. You're going to be so sick and tired of pinning by the time this is done. We're going to our sewing machine now. As far as the type of stitch that you should use for this, I actually just use a straight stitch. I don't do a stretch stitch. You can do the zigzag stitch if you really want to. I personally don't think that you need it. I've been doing this with straight stitches on a couple of projects, and I've never ran into any trouble with it. So if you want to do a zigzag, great. If you don't want to, that's fine too. I always start out by sewing up the other side that's going to be along the wrist, just because it helps me keep the rest of the fabric even as I am sewing. I know, it's entertaining watching me sew, isn't it? I also do a lot of back stitching because the problem areas are always going to be between your fingers. Those are always fun, so I do a lot of back stitching in those areas. Those are typically the weaker points of any type of glove that you make. Alright, now that we're done sewing, I'm going to show you guys really quickly why you use stretchy fabrics. This was a two-way stretch pleather. While it works on one way, it doesn't really work all the way around because it bunches up between the fingers, and that's kind of nasty. This is why you use the four-way stretch, such as spandex. Now that we're done, we turn the glove inside out, and we're going to get the fingers as much as we possibly can. I like to roll them between my fingers to try to push them all the way through. If you find that the ends of the fingers aren't going out properly, get a chopstick and then just gently poke the finger through the rest of the way. Least likely to split your seams. And there you go. That's the final glove. As you can see, it fits me pretty well. I don't have it rolled up all the way, but my fingers move freely. Just keep in mind that the ends on these, they look a little weird because I'm going to be going back through and adding nails inside the glove, so I needed some extra room. But yeah, as you can see, I can move my hands, I can bend them really comfortably. They look very nice and tight, which is exactly the type of look I was going for. I can breathe. They're fantastic. That's why I like this particular glove pattern. But there you go. It's a simple, easy way to make your own gloves for cosplay. Hope you guys enjoy it.
And we're back.
Hi.
I wanted to see the ding, like, you know, the
ding.
Whole, try Obit's gum. I just wanted to see the mouth sparkle when you did that.
My teeth are not that pretty to be Orbit's teeth, so no, we're not doing that. I haven't seen a costume of the Orbit's girl. Maybe somebody should do that.
Hey, if they want to cosplay Flo, then somebody else can cosplay
the Orbit's girl. That'd be funny.
Not Orbit's, Orbit.
Yes.
Singular.
There's a difference. One of them is...
Orbit's is a car company.
Yeah, one of them is a car company.
Yeah, Orbit is a chewing gum company.
Right.
Actually, I think they're owned by somebody else, but yes.
They probably are.
I have seen some really awesome cosplay, you know. I keep wanting, you know, somebody to go to a con. And actually, it would kind of work for PAX. There's not enough time to do it for this year. But if anybody wanted to do it, to make Transformers of all the popular vehicles in popular culture...
Oh, that would be cool.
You can have a Millennium Falcon Transformer.
Yeah,
you can.
You
can have a Kit Transformer.
Know who Kit is, hang on real quick, because we have younger audiences. Kit is from Knight Rider.
Knight Rider.
Go look it up. David Hasselhoff. Go look it up. You should know who the Hoff is. If you don't know, then you were definitely not born more than 5 years ago.
It was one of the first... artificially intelligent machines portrayed on television. Not in movies, in television.
Television.
Yes, Kit was supposedly sentient. So that is who Kit is. And I may have to explain this as well, but you can also have a Transformer of the General.
Yeah, the General Lee kind of needs to be explained, unfortunately. I'm sorry.
Dukes of Hazzard, kids.
Dukes of Hazzard. Though that may not be so bad, because there was the Ben Stiller, Owen Wilson movie, so maybe that's not so bad.
Yes. Yes. And of course, you know, you can always do from Smokey and the Bandit.
That would have been funny.
You know, there are so many, you know, iconic things that you could do. I mean, you could probably even do the Enterprise as a Transformer. There are so many things that you could do.
I would pay to see that. I would pay somebody to see that.
There are creative people that I think could do it. So it would be really neat to have a group of Transformers that were, you know, pop culture icons. I still want to see a group do that.
That would be cool. Maybe one day. Not me. It ain't going to be me. Sorry, no kids. Unless I can make it out of fabric, it ain't happening. I draw the line there.
Well, speaking of uber awesome costumes, we have an uber awesome contest coming up in a little less than 2 months.
Yeah, just shy of 2 months. It's so short.
It is short, but we're actually doing incredibly well on progress for it. You know, basically at this point, we're trying to get the word out, so we fully encourage you guys to share the post that we made on Facebook. You can share the image that's up on our website, because we do have all the details up on our website now, which is cospod.org. And you can also share the information from AllCons page, which I believe is simply all-con.org/cosplay.htm.
.net.
They have both. They own both domains.
.net.
Okay, fine. But please do spread the information around. We would like to get the word out as far as possible, because we would like to encourage people to participate. You know, not just to compete, but to come watch in the audience, because it'll be a good time. It'll be a really
It'll
good
be
time.
Fun. It'll be fun. We've done a lot of things, and we've changed up the contest. We've made new rules. We've got huge prizes coming in. That's been really cool. We've got a lot of good donations there. We have completely new judges, some of them local, one of them not local. So it's going to be a lot of fun. I'm really looking forward to it.
And not only do we have new judges, new rules, new categories, we also have new prizes, which we have worked very hard to get, you know, good, solid cosplay-related prizes for you guys, because we had gotten some feedback from the audience that this is what you guys wanted. So, of course, we're going to try and give you, to an extent, what you want. I mean, we can't pass out booze during the contest. I'm sorry. You know, we can't feed you guys, you know, calamari or sushi. We can't do those sorts of things. But we can give you really awesome cosplay prizes. And if you have not seen the photo of our trophies, that is also up on the website. The trophies are uber awesome.
They
especially
are so
the best
cool.
in show.
Oh my goodness, I can't get over the trophies. Every time I see the box, I have it sealed up now so nothing bad can happen to the trophies. It's sitting in a very safe location in my closet. Every time I open my closet, I squee a little bit. I'm like, there's the trophies, oh my goodness.
And the picture does not entirely do justice to just the shiny factor.
They're super shiny.
And not only that, but we are also trying to get other various prizes so that, you know, the other winners can also share in a little bit of the bounty. You know, we're looking at things like tote bags. We're looking at things like potentially getting a sheet of Warbla. We're looking at gift cards to various cosplay entities, like, say, maybe Arda or
Arda.
And we're also going to keep trying to throw in other things, like, for example, a lot of cosplay authors have started coming out with books recently that are informational about how to do things. You know, how to carve foam, how to do LEDs, how to do armor and strapping. So we're going to try and also get some of those into the gift packages just because we think they'd be useful and appreciated.
They're definitely unique cosplay prizes. I think that was the big thing that Amber and I really wanted on this was we didn't want just, you know, prizes. We wanted cosplay prizes. We wanted something that we knew cosplayers and costumers would really appreciate and get use out of.
Right. And, you know, given the budget that we had to work with, I think we've done incredibly well.
I agree with that one, yeah.
For us this year with the contest, which if this is successful, we may be able to keep doing it. And this is why we ask for your guys' support, because we want this to go really well for the first year. We want to impress AllCon. You know, we want a big audience, we want a big competition turnout, and we want people to have fun, most of all. Even if we don't get to do this for a second year, we still want people to have had fun doing it. And that's kind of our ultimate aim with this. So if you guys have, you know, suggestions, comments, concerns, questions about this, you guys can always contact us. You can always email us. Our address is simply podcast@cospod.org. Or alternatively, if you end up contacting AllCon, they'll forward it over to us. And that way we can get in touch and, you know, allay your concerns.
And so, for anybody who's been trying to enter in the past, we changed up all the rules, so you can pretty much enter with anything at this point. If you want to just be up on the stage and show your stuff off, do it. Enter. We have no restrictions on entering at this point, so just enter. We want everybody to try. And I think with the gift packages that we're coming up with, it's definitely worth your time, you know, for that extra hour and a half, 2 hours you're with us. We promise we'll make it worth your while.
Mm-hmm. And it's on Friday night, and we are holding the contest late enough so that those who have to, you know, run home from work and change clothes, you'll have time to do that. And in fact, we're actually saving you a little bit of time because you guys can register in advance to the contest.
Oh, shocking.
We do have a sign-up form. It is linked on our Facebook so that you guys can sign up for the contest in advance if you wish to compete. That way it'll save you a little bit of time. So all of the rules, all of the information that you need to know, all of it is up on Facebook. I link to it from our website. Like I said, if you guys have any questions beyond that, do let us know. Don't hesitate to ask, because we're here to help. We're here to be helpful people.
And nobody saw that. That's perfect.
I did.
Yeah, you did, which is fine.
Yes, we are excited about the contest, even though we're not like jumping up and down in our chairs, you know, that excited. That's mostly because we've had a few life events just recently happen, both of us. So it's more that we're trying to deal with life at the same time as the contest. So as the contest gets closer and life kind of gets out of the way, you'll probably see us be a little bit more like...
Yeah, exactly. I think I'll start hitting that point when we actually get to the day of the contest and I see people lining up and I'll be like, okay, this is actually happening now. Yay!
And we do have a very good MC lined up to host.
Oh, yes, our
MC. We are not actually hosting ourselves. As much as that would be easy, we don't think the audience would appreciate what would effectively be another episode of CosPod. So we have a very talented MC that will host for us, and we will take care of the administrative work behind the scenes. We're also not judging, so don't hesitate because you think there may be conflict of interest because you're our friends. We're not judging. In fact, we don't influence the scores in any sort of way.
No.
So you can enter without hesitation. It's cool. We're going to be kind of the behind-the-scenes people.
Yeah, we are going to be the quote-unquote assistants behind the scenes, keeping the cosplayers in line, helping them out with directions, getting them water. Or we are going to be hauling our butts around.
Spotters.
Yep. Exactly. Exactly. So you don't have to worry about us. We promise we're not there to freak anybody out. We're not going to influence anything. And in fact, our judging system is all numbers based anyway. It's very similar to what AllCon has requested of us. So trust me, our involvement in terms of the judging process is going to be non-existent. At most, we'll be there to add numbers.
Yeah, we'll be adding numbers and we'll be giving the judges instructions, basically saying, here are the judging forms. Here is how they should be filled out. Have a good time. That's effectively it. And then we basically just walk away.
Yeah, we scamper off to help the cosplayers at that point.
Yep. So it'll be fun. Spread the word. Please participate. Even if it's in the audience, please participate by competing. If you cannot, that's cool. Please help us out by spreading the word. It takes all of 10 seconds to share the post. And we would really sincerely appreciate that, because that really does help us out. We're kind of pulling our hair out, trying to find better ways to market this. We don't want to like throw it in your face like, here's a pop-up ad, come to AllCon. No, we're not going to do that. We're not going to be inappropriate about it. So we would like to be able to market this in a non-intrusive sort of way by just saying, hey, here's a contest. We'd really like you to participate. Here's all the information you need. Please spread the word. That's all. That's as intrusive as it will be. So we're asking you guys to help us out. Please spread the word.
We want good things to come from this. That's the whole thing.
We really do. This is kind of our baby and has been for the last few months. And even now, we're still trying to get sponsors for prizes just to make it that much better.
Mm-hmm. We want to make it extra special for everybody.
We do. We want to give incentive to people because we know that cosplay is hard work. I mean, we've both been cosplaying forever. So we know we've been there. We've competed. We've seen pretty much every angle of competition, including as judges. So we feel that we have an understanding of it. So we want to kind of give you guys a little bit of a push to come and have a good time. We'll have awesome music, too.
Oh, we will have awesome music, yes, because I've got it confirmed that Cosplay with me, who is actually a good friend of mine, too, so that's really good. He do a lot of cosplay music videos, and they also do a lot of cosplayer interviews. They're going to be our halftime show, so there you go. That'll keep us entertained, too.
So you'll have that, and we will also have some awesome music for those who are competing. It won't just be your standard... You're walking across the stage. We'll find something tasteful.
And not Pokemon either.
No offense to other contests that have done that. Just as competitors, we'd like something a little different.
A little change up would be fantastic, that's all.
Yes, and you know, there is a possibility, I can't promise this will happen, we'll have to take a look at this, but for those who do register in advance, we may be able to find some series appropriate music for you to walk across the stage to. Because we have time to plan.
There's a thought, huh?
If you're a Legend of Zelda cosplayer and you happen to sign up early, that gives us time enough to go find a Legend of Zelda music clip for you. And that helps you, and it helps us, and everything, you know, fits together very well. So help us out to help you. Just say
help us help you.
Yes.
Oh, goodness.
I'm good.
All right, good.
All right, we're going to call a close to this episode 81 of CosPod, the podcast for all things cosplay. I would like to end with giving a shout-out to Cosplay Boom. I see they've started, you know, taping episodes again. Also to, what was it, Trade Paper Books?
Trade Paper Hacks.
Trade Paper Hacks. Also, shout-out to them. Make sure that you guys watch Val when she is on the podcast tomorrow. And last, I believe one of our correspondents is also having a hangout today.
Right. If you get really tired of us in the next couple of minutes, which I'm sure you will, no. Katie, our East Coast correspondent, also called Broken Mirror Cosplay, she's having an all-day cosplay event through Google Hangout. So check her out on her Facebook page. We do have her linked up there. Give her a watch. She's very entertaining.
Mm-hmm. If you guys, the Podders, our audience, if you guys have cosplay events like this that you are holding, let us know and we can tell people about it. You know, we can't necessarily endorse everybody simply because we're kind of limited in what we can endorse with our name, but we will be happy to spread the word and just say, hey, you know, this person is having a charity event in this city for cosplay, please attend. So, you know, if you have an event, just let us know. We're happy to share. And until our next cosplay event, we will see you guys in episode 82, where we will have even more awesome content for you. We will see you guys next time.
Bye!